You're listening to Guitar Talk with Dave and Michael.
All right, everybody, welcome back to season two of Guitar Talk. As you can see, the guy next to me is Mike Olienchak, otherwise known around the industry as Mike O. Mike O will be the guest host for this season. Mike, how are you doing?
I'm doing fine. How are you doing, Dave?
I'm great. We're dealing with this ridiculous pandemic. I think people are home on YouTube learning a hell of a lot of songs, because every time I put up a lesson, it's like instantly getting hammered, and people are like, and all my old videos now, at like 2 a.m, all of a sudden I'll get ding, 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 and I'll see all these comments on my page, something about like, oh, can you do this song? And I love this one. So people are home working on, you know, songs and whatnot.
Yeah, so maybe there's some good that's coming out of this.
No. I don't think we could put a good spin on it, but it is what it is. And has it affected your work at all?
Yes. I have a job, obviously. And the company that I work for, we are considered essential. It's a manufacturing company. And they make products that are used by oil and gas industry, healthcare, aerospace, NASA, and things like that. And so we're considered essential. So at this point, I am still working.
Wow. All right. Yeah. That's great. Yeah. I mean, I've had to, we were talking before we started this show, and I was telling you, I have to, teach from home, do the Skype stuff, doing a lot more Skype lessons. Obviously the gigs have canceled, so because the bars aren't open. So that's been kind of tough. Somebody brought this up to me during one of my live streams, and we were talking about the industry and sales and stores. And I was talking about how, like, a lot of local stores, including Guitar Center, just hire cashiers. You know, like, those people are not really going to help you find something you're looking for. They're cashiers to take your money. You look for something, they're like, yeah, here it is, buddy. You want a beginner guitar? Sure, they'll sell you a Squire box, whatever that. But for the most part, these stores are really going to suffer with all this. What is your thoughts on stores like Guitar Center and how they're going to do during all these shutdowns?
Well, I imagine just like anybody else, like someone just flicked the switch and the lights are off, you know. Whether it be a Guitar Center or a Target or a Walmart, for that matter. But I take that back. Target and Walmart would probably still be open because they sell essential things. Musical items, not essential, so they're closed. They've got an online leg, and, you know, you and I both know, and a lot of other people, that they're, you know, it is Musician's Friend and 123 and whatever. They've got a lot of brands under their umbrella. So I think they can spread that pain out or those losses.
I can't imagine that they'd still be doing better than Sweetwater.
You know what? You bring up Sweetwater. Now, you and I had our feet in the industry, have our feet in the industry, but also as users, you know, a consumer. And I'll speak as a consumer right now. Sweetwater is an interesting entity because they do very well, okay? I don't find myself buying a lot from them, though, you know? At the end of the day, they don't really seem to have sales, okay? You know, and that's what motivates me. And, every time that I have an interest in something, I have a need, I look at Musician's Friend, I look at Sweetwater, I look at whatever else I look at. And at the end of the day, I'll just say, more than likely, I'm not buying it from Sweetwater. What about you on that?
I think a lot of that might be that you have industry savvy. I mean, you worked for Gibson, you had your own company, there's an industry savvy that you probably would just buy used, especially depending on what you're looking for. Mm. But the thing with Sweetwater with me is it's the only company I buy from because
interesting.
When I because if I see it somewhere else, I'll just call the guy over at Sweetwater and tell him will he match it, and he will. And but Sweetwater, if it's an instrument or it's anything like that, they're always on top of you. They're like, "What do you need? What can I do for you?" It's way more personal. If you're buying a guitar, they have pictures of the actual guitar with the serial number. You could tell them, "Hey, I want it set up with tens or nines. Can you do this? Can you do that?" And they're pretty damn good. They're part of the customer service industry that's dying. That when I deal with musician's friend or anything like that, I really just don't care because I know it's Guitar Center and I know it's like, I just know what I'm dealing with Guitar Center, and I don't like it. You know, when you go in a Guitar Center, like, just imagine if you had a gig and you needed an amp stand, all right? You walk into a Guitar Center, are they going to have the amp stand you want? It's happened to me twice. They didn't. And it's like, how come you don't have the standard? Oh, they have some other off-brand or whatever, or sometimes they don't have them. We don't really carry amp stands. Well, it's like, it's something, it's a product that should be right there, like mic stands and everything else. And it should just be a good, better, and best. You know, don't give me 900 choices, just give me the three. What's the expensive? What's the one that's going to be the rugged, probably last the longest, the best value? And then show me the cheap ass one if I want to throw it out my window the next gig. You know what I mean? Like, I just think that's really...
Well, I don't find myself in Guitar Center locally in the store at the brick and mortar. You know, when you mentioned about selection, availability, I go in those stores or the one that's here locally, and I'm in the Cleveland area, Ohio, and, you know, there's not a good selection there. There just isn't, you know? And so it's hard to compete a brick and mortar, even a Guitar Center, with online, whether it be Sweetwater, Musician's Friend, or whatever. And, you know, like you said, you can have it in 2 days. I didn't realize that Sweetwater does some of the things that you mentioned, so that's going to make me revisit them. Okay.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Because I didn't know that they were that aggressive with price matching. You know, I have to admit that's going to be a big motivator for me. I knew that their service was, you know, top of the heap. I'll put it that way. That everyone's chasing them in regards to that level of service. I knew that already. But I didn't know that the price matching thing, so that's going to make me look at them a little differently now.
What happens when you buy something from them or you want to call them, you'll get a sales guy, and that sales guy will be your guy forever.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. And then he follows up with you because I have purchased stuff from them, and actually I purchased a rack case just recently, maybe within 2 months, you know, and, rack case, I think maybe wasn't available when I purchased it. And he said, oh, it'll be here within like a week or so. And, they received it in less than that time. He contacted me and said, hey, it's going to come out. It came out. I had it in a couple of days. And then he followed up too. Hey, did you get it? Like you said, is everything okay? That, whatever. And I have to admit, I do not get that kind of service from Musician's Friend.
Yeah. And the cool thing, again, is if you call the guy and you said, hey, listen, I see these guys have this for this price. Can you got? They'll be like, don't worry about it. Done. What else? They're very, very good. I think that company is really well run. But my thing about it is like what you're saying about there's incidentals that you can't. Now, you can order strings online and get a great price by buying a 10-pack, a 3-pack, a bulk set. No matter what, sometimes you're in a bind, you need to buy strings.
Sure.
Well, stores gotta have a great string selection. That's one. And then the other thing is you should have a great pedal selection, because pedals are, and I've spoken about this, they're a paycheck away.
They're a paycheck away, and they're an impulse buy. Most of the time. You know what I mean? Meaning that somebody comes in, you know, they're looking around, maybe they're picking up some strings, they look down, it's brightly colored pedal, it's yellow, it's green, it's red, it's whatever it is. And, you know, they got a couple of minutes, hey, plug me in, and then they're walking out the door a couple hundred bucks later.
But you're also going to have incidentals. You're going to have amp stands, mic stands. You're going to need chart paper. You're going to need, these are just things that people in the course of a day will find themselves needing and not being prepared for, that they want to go into a store and be able to buy.
Well, and get an instrument cable, mic cable, you know, yes, cabling of any type, maybe picks, you know.
All that stuff.
Yeah.
And when Guitar Center can't do that.
They don't do that well, in my opinion. You would think a store of that size. And matter of fact, I was looking for, this is a few months ago, guitar slides, you know, because I've always been a real fan of it. And I decided, you know, I'm tired of thinking I'm going to do this, you know, next year or whatever. I better start on it now. I'm not getting any younger. And, you know, so I was looking for guitar slides and I figured, well, Guitar Center probably has a good selection. It's a big store. Long story short, I go in there, not a good selection at all. You know, so I ended up online. That's tough because you're, you know, Sweetwater Musician's Friend had a much better selection, but you couldn't touchy-feely put it on your finger and felt like, okay, that one fits, you know? Yeah.
How about this, when you go into a store, because people here that are watching this and meeting you basically for the first time don't really know much about you, but imagine you walk into a store and you're looking at an amplifier and they don't qualify you about it, about something. You know, they don't ask you, what do you have? Are you familiar with these? You know what I mean? Because it happens all the time. And you have like quite a collection of amplifiers that make mine look dwarfed.
Yeah, I've got a few amps.
Yeah. I mean, you have a problem, let's be honest.
Yes, I've been told that by many people that I have a problem. But yeah, I do. But I am, like you, I've been in this industry for a while, and whether it be in retail or actually working for a musical instrument manufacturer. And I guess I rationalized some of it as, you know, it's part of the business, you know, these are tools, you know, at least that's what I used to tell my ex-wife.
Right.
Yeah. And, you know, but with that being said, I don't know. You got to spend your money on something, right?
Sure. Yeah. Well, it looks like I could see a Marshall head right over your shoulder there. Is that a head or is it a combo? Over your left shoulder? Yeah, what is that? Oh, is that a Marshall? No, it's not.
This one? This shoulder?
Yeah. Yeah. Are there amps back there?
Well, yeah, there's amps. They're kind of everywhere. I had a JCM 800 112 combo, but the baffle had an issue, and, you know, that's not necessarily screwed in, that's glued in on that particular combo cabinet. And I just decided, you know, I'm just going to make it a head. And somebody had gone into it at some point, because it was like it's a vertical input, so it's early 80s.
Right.
And someone had gone into it at some point and changed a bunch of the caps out and stuff like that, you know, tone caps,
right?
Not filter caps or anything like that. And so when I decided to turn it into a head, I'm looking at it going like, you know, I'm probably going to have to do whatever I'm going to have to do to this. I just pulled the circuit board out and I built a turnt board and, you know, just basically built a new board for it and dropped it in, you know. So it's actually sitting on I've got a chassis holder to work on amps, and it's sitting on the chassis holder on a 212 cab right now. And it's been sitting there for a year. I mean, I've got the head box already. Mojo made me the head box, and that's sitting over there too. I just haven't gotten around to putting it in the head box yet.
Yeah.
Wow. So, yeah. So no combos. I'm really not a combo kind of guy, but I do have some combos, But yeah. I much prefer heads. What about you?
Well, I like combos, mainly because I'm lazy. I mean, if I'm playing in a hard rock band, yeah, I'll take a head and a 4x12. But I mean, for the most part, if I'm playing, I like a Princeton size combo. I play mainly this hot rod, and I have a Marshall over here, a JCM. JCM 900. 2501.
Yep.
So it's a Mark III head, basically a Mark III 50 watt with a 1x12, which I like the Mark IIIs and the JCM 900s more so than the late 800s.
The late 800s, at that point, they had gone to two channels, okay? And they were channels.
Well, the 2205 and the 2210s, yeah, the two channels.
The two-channel ones, I don't like those either. The lead channel is overly compressed, and the early ones had some kind of a bleed between the channels that they had corrected at some point.
Right.
But at the end of the day, they corrected that, but the lead channel, I still didn't like. You know.
Well, the lead channel, I believe they were using a diode clipping in the channel.
Yeah.
Without telling people that it was. And when the 900s came out, that's when they started with the first model, which is basically the 2500 and the 2100. I have a 2100 over here.
Mm-hmm.
The 2100 was basically a 2203 with a clipping diode on a pod. So you could take it out of the circuit. You know?
I'm nodding. Okay.
Yeah. So it's
nothing, different components, you know, in a circuit can create drive, and they'll have a voice or a character to it, you know? And sometimes when you combine that with another type of overdrive, it's not a bad sound, you know, hence people putting solid state pedals in front of tube amps. You know, right. For years, that's definitely a magical combination. And sometimes you can take a really, weak product, let's say like a pedal that's really not that good, but you put it in front of a really good amp and the combination can end up being a really good combination. Like you wouldn't think, but it just kind of works out good, you know?
Well, yeah, go ahead.
I was going to say, and I'm not a big Tube Screamer fan, but, that's been... the secret sauce for a lot of guys for decades, and for a lot of guys it works. I'm just not a big Tube Screamer fan. I would rather put something else in front of the Marshall or the Fender or whatever.
Well, I think in front of a Fender or in front of something like a whatever Fender circuit. What is that circuit that Dumble made? The string swinger, the string singer, something like that. That's a real
steel string singer,
right? So something like that, where it's like no compression, it's just a super heavy, loud, clean amp. I think the Tube Screamer sounds pretty good in front of it. Marshalls, I do not think sound good with a Tube Screamer. In fact, that's why I think so many guys in the early 70s were using a treble boost, because treble boosts, I think, pushed the Marshall sound to a better place.
I would agree with that. And then also back in the 70s, MXR Distortion Plus found itself on the floor in front of a lot of Marshalls. Hence, Randy Rhodes.
That's the whole Blizzard of Oz sound right there.
Yeah.
It's funny. I never cared for the JVM sound, the later Marshalls, but I really liked the Vintage Modern. And I know a lot of people don't like that amp. I think it's a good amp.
I'm trying to remember, Vintage Modern, is that KT-77s or 66s? There's something different about the power.
Oh, it is? I don't know.
I mean, it's one of the two. It's not, 5881s. It's not you know, 6L6 or EL34s. It's like it's KT66s or 77s. It's one of those two.
Oh, all right. I didn't know. I just know that it's a good sounding amp.
It is. Who do I like that used that for a while, or maybe still does? Paul Gilbert was a big fan of that amp at point.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if he is now, but I know he was.
Oh, it's a great sounding amp. I think it's great. You know. So tell me, what is the rarest Marshall amp you have? Like, what is your if somebody was to say, I'm going to take one of your amps down to the Vegas pawn shop there. What's that pawn? One that's going to have them. I got to call a friend and have them.
That one's tough because it's like when I think of what might be the most desirable to a player. It's probably, I've got a 69 Plexi that would probably be that, but it's more of a player's amp. So it's beat, you know, it's not, you know, pawn shop clean, friendly, so to speak.
Right.
You know, but if it was pawn,
but I think has Mark played that amp? Cause I think Mark has mentioned that amp or one of your amps.
No, he didn't play that. He didn't play. Well, you know what? Did he? I don't think he has. I think he's played through, you know, because I've got some of the amps I've had longer than others, needless to say, and so I've bonded with some more than others, and one that I've had maybe might be the longest, maybe, is I've got a 79 JMP, you know, so it's a master volume, you know, high level sure. input. 100 watt, yeah, 100 watt, and nice. That amp just, there's not a bad sound in it. It's just,
right.
It was made on probably a Wednesday before lunch kind of a vibe, you know, it just sounds great.
It's Judas Priest amp, isn't it?
Well, you know what, I remember reading once, or someone told me, I can't remember, both. You know, the JMPs, the master volumes, all came into play for Bad Company, of all bands. I guess they were instrumental in making that happen.
Oh, really?
For whatever reason. Okay.
Bad Company album would have come out. That would have been 76 or Run with the Pack, maybe.
Well, the first album would have been earlier. You know, because
74 for sure.
Yeah, I bet it was 74 on the first album. I'm thinking.
Yeah.
You know,
You think they made that a prototype for them? You think? Because I think
that's what I was told that they were a big part of those amps happening.
Wow.
Yeah, or that model happening.
So yeah, it wouldn't be so far stretched because I mean that's what Marshall did. He would listen to people and
yeah.
Whoever was the flavor of the day was basically going in there making suggestions to them.
And those guys were, they were all over the radio. That first album was huge. The second album was huge. I think it petered off a little bit on Run with the Pack. The third album, you mentioned that one.
I liked Run with the Pack a lot better than the Straight Shooter album. I thought there were better songs on Run with the Pack. I liked the song Run with the Pack. I loved Silver, Blue, and Gold.
Silver, Blue, and Gold's a good tune.
Oh, it's great.
And let me see, what else would you have on there? Live for the Music.
Right, Live for the Music's on that album.
And was Honey Child on that album?
Honey Child, yes.
Okay. And there was something else. You know what? They did that remake, that 50 song, Youngblood.
Youngblood.
Was on that one, too. Yeah. Yeah, that's a good album. I mean, actually, you know what? In the fourth album was really, really good, I thought, was Desolation Angels.
Well, I think it's the fifth. I think, you know why you're considering it the fourth? Because the other album had nothing except for Burning Sky on it.
I thought Burning Sky was after Desolation Angels.
I think Burning Sky, I'll look it up. I think Burning Sky is 77 or 78. Desolation Angels is 79, which I think is their best album. I've gone on record on my channel many yeah. times before saying that I think it's their best album. And then they took a break and they got back in 82 and did Rough Diamonds.
But that was with the without Paul Rodgers at that point, right?
Oh, Rough Diamonds was Paul Rodgers. They broke up and they got back together. It had Painted Face was a big hit for him on that record, and the other song was Electric Land.
Okay.
I'm just a stranger in Electric Land. I love that tune. Hold on, let me look up the
He's such a good singer. I've been a fan of him since, you know, the Free days.
Great. I'm
a huge Free fan. And it's hard to beat Paul. And he seems like he's the class act, too. He really does.
Yeah.
Speaking of when you mentioned Desolation and Angels, I remembered that I saw that tour. I saw them, you know, in the Cleveland area back in the day. They would have been at the Richfield Coliseum. With that being said, it made me think of something else now. A question. What was the first concert you went to?
Aerosmith.
Oh, cool. Do you remember what they were touring? Rock and
Hard Place tour.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, Burning Sky came out in 77.
Wow.
Which was great. So I love the sky.
Yeah.
And then Desolation Angels, 79. Now, I've said this many times. Desolation Angels, side one, is better than any Bad Company album. Forget about side two. And side two still had good songs. Lonely for Your Love, Oh Atlanta, Rhythm Machine, She Brings Me Love. But Rock and Roll Fantasy, Crazy Circles, Gone, 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 Evil Wind, and Early in the Morning. I love that whole setup. I love that record.
That's a great album. It's hard to beat.
Yeah.
I'm undecided though right now, because I really like the first album a lot, you know, so I would have to listen to them both again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the first album for me just burns me out though, because I've had enough of Moving On. I've had enough of every band covering Can't Get Enough of Your Love. I like Ready for Love, but Rock Steady again, enough. I'm so sick of people with an acoustic guitar who think they do a touching version of Seagull. I'm like,
you know what I would rather hear than Seagull? Isn't Simple Man on the first album?
No. Simple Man was, I think, Run with the Pack.
Wow, because I like that song a lot.
Hold on, let me just look here. Bad Company. Discography, Run with the Pack. Yeah, second song on Run with the Pack.
Wow. Okay, that's a good tune.
Yeah, I'm telling you, Run with the Pack's a great album. It's way better. Look, Straight Shooter. Like, I don't even like Good Lovin' Gone Bad.
I like that tune. I like it a lot better than what's the other single from that record? Feel Like Making Love would have been the second album.
And Shooting Star.
Yeah, you know, back in the day, I liked both of those. But you want to talk about, you know, like you were talking about songs that had your fill of.
Yeah.
I've had my fill of those two songs.
Absolutely. That's why I think, and those are the two best songs on the album. Because the album's not that good. I mean, Weep No More, Deal With the Preacher I Don't Like, Wildfire Woman. I didn't care for the record. So
it's been a long time since I've listened to them.
Yeah.
Typically, if I'm craving that, I have to admit, I'll default to Free. What's your thoughts on Free?
I like Free a lot, but it's before my time. But I went back to them. But, yeah, I mean, I love All Right Now, obviously. And I love Wishing Well's a great tune. Fire and Water's a great tune. There's a blues song that they do that I really like. What's that?
I was going to mention Mr. Big, you know, hence with the Big.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where Mr. Big got their name. You know, so a connection from something as old as Free to now is, you know, Paul Kossoff was a very influential guitar player. And I think probably the thing that's the most trademark of his that I hear in players, and Bonamassa comes to mind first, is his vibrato. You know, and I've heard like Joe mention it in a few interviews when he talks about, he's very open. And I think it's funny where he says, I forgot how he words it, but he basically says, you know, he's not doing anything original. Everything he does, he stole from somebody else, you know? And, but I do hear a lot of that in him, a lot of Paul Kossoff in him.
When I think of Paul Kossoff, I instantly think of Ace Frehley on the first three Kiss albums.
I know what you're talking about.
Because I just think that every riff is just a Kossoff riff that Ace is playing.
Yeah, and it's probably the same riff. I've always felt that he, and, you know, I'm probably just asking for it with this one, but, you know, he his level of playing, his arsenal, there, you know, there just wasn't a lot there.
Well, no, I mean, I think Ace was pretty good for back then, but I think he was drawing a lot on Kossoff. And I think a lot of people don't realize that, but if you listen to early Free, it's just like, oh, there's a lot of Ace's legs.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
yeah, I can't argue with that. And because I can hear it now, I mean, he'd grab a note like Paul would, and he'd hang on it, and he'd really work the vibrato on it, you know. Yeah. And he was kind of a position one. Actually, everything was position one with him for the most part.
Think of the song Cold. You know Cold Gin? Were you ever a Kiss fan?
I saw them back in the day when they still used to wear makeup.
Okay, so before they ever took it off.
Before they took it off, I want to think it was 77 I saw them, I think.
Oh, wow. That would be the Love Gun tour, probably. So you know the song Cold Gin?
Sure.
Think of that riff. It's almost the same riff as All Right Now. It's the same chord shapes. Same.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
I never put that, like, those two together, but you are onto something there.
Yeah, and I also think it has a lot to do with playing the Les Paul. Like, I think a lot of people that play the Les Paul play that vibrato because I think the instrument beckons a lot of that stuff. Like, I can tell when I listen to a classic rock record and I hear the lead guitar go sharp when he plays high on the neck, I know they're playing a Les Paul. Because on a Les Paul, it's really hard not to bend sharp.
And because of the shorter scale, the strings are more relaxed, it's real easy to go over it. I agree. Yes.
And it happens on a lot of records. It happens with a lot of players. And when I hear it, I'm always like, oh, that's a Paul. That's the only way I'd be able to say, oh, that's a Les Paul. Yeah, it's got to be. Because, you know, Strat guys usually won't run into that. Especially back in the day when guys, you know, all these Strat guys were like trying to be like, I use 10s, I use 11s, or Stevie uses 13s, you know. Then you're not going to be bending sharp for sure with that. But
well, that, especially in the 70s, you had, you know, 7 1/4 radiuses. Oh, I'm a little bit older than you, and you know, so I was playing in the 70s. I was in high school in the later 70s, and I had a Strat and a Les Paul, and I know exactly what you're talking about. I mean, I struggled to play anything on a Strat back then. You know, I mean, because you had 3 single coil pickups, you didn't have a lot of gain; they were fairly weak. And you had the 7 1/4 radius. It was a 70 Strat, and production values were pretty bad at that point. And you know, they used to fret them and then shoot the lacquer. You know, and so you had lacquer on the frets, and then it would all like prick and peel off. Yeah. You know, and it was bad. Man, it was bad. And that would have been the 3-bolt time, and that's what I had. I had a 3-bolt Strat, maple neck, heavy. It was heavy.
Was it natural?
And they did that on purpose.
Or was it painted?
No, it was red. Okay. It was red with a black pickguard, black plastic, and because, you know, that was all 70s. Yeah. And, you know, they were making them heavy back then, and I don't know how many people know this. they were doing that on purpose. They were making them as heavy as they could because they were up against the guitar of choice at that time, which was the Les Paul. Les Pauls were known to be heavy, and there was a general consensus back then, if you look at all the old guitar player magazines, that heavy would equate to more sustain, okay? And so they were, at Fender, were making the guitars heavy on purpose. And I found this out, you know, you mentioned I worked for Gibson at one point. I worked for Fender at one point, too. And so I found out a bunch of behind-the-scenes stuff when I worked at Fender, and that was one of the things that was that I found out, for what it's worth.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, it's funny the way people are about with the whole sustain and everything, and just, you know, the whole industry. For a manufacturer not to know, I find hard to believe that when they're going out selling this stuff, we're using the thin skin nitrous cellulose. Oh, that's going to sound better. Like, how the hell, like, you're paying a premium for this. How do I know that's thin skin nitrous cellulose? How do I know that, how thin the coat, you know what I mean? It's like, it's so absurd.
And a lot of it's a
snake oil business.
I agree. And it's all, and you know, it's all trendy and buzz, you know? And so somebody says, you know, lighter is better, and everyone's trying to make things as light as they can. You know, thin finishes are better, so everyone's trying to do that. And with that being said, I've seen people play, you know, instruments that were really not very good through amplifiers that maybe weren't that good either, and they would sound great, you know? So
Jimmy Page on Cashmere, he's playing a Dan Electro, tuned in Dadgad. It's a piece of shit guitar. Thing sounds fantastic.
You know, he used that thing a lot. He, if it's the one I'm thinking of, that was his slide guitar. He used it a lot for slide. And so, like, In My Time of Dying and anything else that he did slide stuff with, he gravitated towards that guitar. And, yeah, it's a POS.
Yeah.
It's a piece of shit. But he's bonded to it for whatever reason, and he gets some great tones out of it. That and the amp, I'm trying to remember, he had a combo. I'm trying to remember the brand the combo was right now. It's kind of a...
Oh, yeah. I almost want to say it. Supro was the name of the amp.
That's
That's
it. Supro. And
Valco was the parent company at that time,
And Valco was probably making amps for... I wouldn't doubt they made the Silvertone stuff in addition to the Supro stuff. You know, maybe, you know, back in the day.
Right. Yeah. Well, I mean, the Silvertone stuff was all Dan Electro. They were making the Silvertone stuff, and then I think it was Airline, that was another cheap company, was also making the Montgomery Ward stuff.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that stuff. You know, at the end of the day, it's, you know, there's no wrong or no right, I guess is what I want to say right now. It's like pizza toppings and ice cream flavors. It's whatever someone likes, whatever speaks to them, whatever they bond with, whatever works.
Well, somebody said this the other day. A bad player will sound good if the tone is good. If I think if you pick up anything, if you picked up, if Tommy Emmanuel picked up the shittiest acoustic guitar, he's going to play something where you're going to be like, how much is that acoustic? You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Within reason, the guy plays a Maton, but let's just say he could pick up a Collings and a Yamaha and make both sound very good.
Yep.
But a guy who's not a great player is not going to pick up a Les Paul and a Plexi Marshall and sound like God. It's just not going to be a good tone. It's just going to sound like, yeah, you're not going to sit there and go, oh, that sounds good.
Now, to add to that, no, number one, I do agree with you on that. But to add to that, the tone equation, you've got the guitar and you've got the amp. I feel, based on conversations I've had, that most people tend to lean towards, they feel that the guitar is the bigger part of the equation. Like, let's say maybe 75% of the equation for tone and the amp is 25%. I'm of the other camp where I believe it's the other way. I think your amp is 75% of your tone and the guitar is 25%. You know, and the player obviously factors in there also. But I do believe that, you know, if we're talking good and bad equipment, you can have a not so good guitar through a great amp. You're going to sound pretty good. You take an amazing guitar.
Might be high.
Yeah.
I do. I think it's less than that. Here's one of my guitars. All right. So this is a Mexican Strat that I bought on Craigslist for $300.
Nice.
Instantly, I sold the neck for $140 right back on Craigslist the day I bought this. I also sold the whole pickup assembly to get rid of it. And I bought this pickup assembly with a DiMarzio 5858 and a Pro 54. The neck is Wenge with an ebony fingerboard I got from Warmoth. I had it with a Clapton V-neck. And I had a trophy shop laser the logo. And then I had it filled with acrylic paint and then sealed.
Because
you can't make a logo white over a black, over a dark wood guitar, because a water slide won't do it. So I had to use paint. Anyways, this thing plays like a custom shop. I've had a few of the frets, high notes, scalloped. You can see those up there.
Yeah.
So it plays, it's stainless steel frets. It's a 10 to 16 radius. It plays like a dream. Now, could I have kept the original pickups? Let's say they were noise canceling, because these are, but let's just say for the argument, if they were, I may hate the way the guitar sounds, but when I play it, somebody listening is going to say that guitar sounds great.
Yeah.
So pickups are, I think, are a lot of what the player wants to hear, how it responds.
I would agree with you. I think gear in general is that, and in that, if a player feels good about what he's hearing and how it's reacting to him, how it feels, they're going to play better and they're going to feel better about it, which allows them to play even better. Okay.
Right.
I do want to touch on the pickups, because you mentioned the DiMarzio pickups. I think DiMarzio makes the best noise canceling single coil pickups.
Agreed.
Bar none.
Agreed. Yeah.
You know,
agreed. Sound like, so when we were running West LA, we used to carry all the Fender custom shops. We had a wall of Fender custom shops, and we had somebody with one of these types of setups and compared them, and we were like, they sound the same except these have no noise. And so it was kind of like a, and so that's kind of what I like. But someone could sit there and say, well, I don't like the sound of the Marzio, I like Duncan's, for whatever reason, and I don't really want to get into that. You know, people will say whatever. And
sure,
maybe they had a bad experience. I know great players that have said that. I know great players who say they like Duncan's or they like Lindy Fralin's noiseless and whatever. But the point I'm saying is I could pick up any of them or if Robin Trower were to borrow my guitar and go play on stage and play, people are going to sit there and go, sounds fantastic. It sounds like Robin Trower. The guitar
that's not
coming to play, other than it's a Strat.
Yep. Yeah, that's when the player, the hand tone comes in and all that. I've seen a lot of interviews where, seems like a bunch of the interviews I've seen where that comes into play, that whole hand tone thing, is it'll be someone talking about getting to play in Eddie Van Halen's rig. And they were like, oh, matter of fact, I just saw an interview with Nuno where he got a chance to play Eddie's rig. And he was like, oh, wow, this is it. You know, cause he looked up to Eddie, obviously, you know, his playing style, this, that, whatever. And, he played it and he was like, man, I sound like me. You know, he didn't sound like Eddie.
Right.
You know? And that's when it's all the hand tone then at that point, how you attack it and, you know, whatever else you do, blah, blah, blah. Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's all that, because you could pick up I've done it before too. I've had somebody play an acoustic guitar for me and I'm like, can I see that guitar? And then I pick it up and play it. And person that was listening to both of us play was like, wow, that sounds so much different when he plays it.
Oh, yeah.
Not good or bad. I'm not sitting there saying, oh, look at the way I play. I'm saying as far as, it's just there's differences. You know, someone plays a different sound and everyone has their own, you know, some people play and it's real aggressive. Some people have a light touch. And it really affects the instrument and the song, whatever you're playing. So it's like, the funny part is it all comes down to, at the end of the day, it's all about songs. Could you imagine if we talked to Mick Ralphs and Mick Ralphs says, oh, my guitar had the best tone on Deal with the Preacher. Oh, yes, the song sucks. You know what I mean? No one would care anymore because people would see that. That's the reality of how important tone is. If Jimmy Page said, my best tone that I think my guitar sounds the best on is Hot Dog. Oh, okay. Get the fuck away from me, will you? You know what I mean? Be like, what are you talking about? Like, who cares? Like, oh, that. Are you really happy about his tone now? You know what I mean? It really gets nuts that people are so up on the tone is so important. It's like, imagine if Jimmy Page said, you know, the worst tone I ever had was on 10 Years Gone. It'd be like, really? If he was serious, saying, I just didn't like the tone. It didn't sound good in the studio. I'll tell you, it was Andy Johns I knew. And Andy Johns told me one time, he says, the Voxes that they're making today sound 10 times better than the bullshit they were making in the 60s. And these assholes that play in bands will tell you that they were much better back then. Listen to the recordings. And he was like, do you know how hard it was to make that thing sound good? They were terrible. He used to tell me they were terrible back then. He was saying he wanted to get a new Vox because he couldn't believe how good they were compared to the old ones.
Isn't that interesting?
And he's the engineer, you know what I mean, that's sitting recording all these records.
Yeah, that is interesting. And actually, that's one of the few animals I don't have right now is a Vox amplifier.
I don't have a Vox. See the eyes light up, everybody? Yeah. He doesn't have a Vox. He's got how many Marshalls? 30 Marshalls?
Give or take. Well,
give us some amps. I just said, because we're getting close to the end of this episode, give everybody a little taste of some amps that you have. Go tell people some brands of amps you have. And
I've got a nice collection of Marshalls, and let me see, I've got Hi-Watt. Let me see what else I got. I've got a couple PRS amps, which is that Doug Sewell guy, collaborated with him, and they're making amps. And I actually think that those amps are highly underrated. I feel that they're really making a good product and have been for more than a few years now, and he struggled in the marketplace with those. And I think just because the company's identified so strongly with guitars that, I don't know. I'm assuming some people were like, oh, they think they're going to make amps, type thing, but the amps are really good. And he's a big Marshall guy. And so a lot of those are based on Marshall circuits, or even more than based on it. I mean, they really are just kind of like duping it in a lot of cases. And those are really good amps. I don't know. Let me see what else. Got to think. Oh, I've got some newer boutique stuff, in addition to like the older amps that I have. Germino.
I know those amps. Which Germino do you have?
I had a few of them, and then I just kind of trimmed it down to one. I was kind of cleaning house at one point.
They're really nice. He does a good job.
They're really nice. He builds a good amp. It's a 20, it's a 6V6 Plexi. So it's in that kind of 20 to 25 watt range.
Sure.
Four input, really good amp. Really good amp. I also got a David Bray. Okay. He's a Marshall knockoff guy.
Yeah.
What else sticking on that? Rocket Retro. He's a Plexi knockoff guy. I've got one of those.
Have you heard of Red Plate?
I've heard of them.
Yeah, he makes a good amp.
I don't think I've ever played through one.
Yeah.
I've heard of them. I mean, I didn't always used to live where I'm in the Cleveland, Ohio area. I used to be in Nashville for a while. And so that was a nice place to be because I got access to a lot of gear maybe I wouldn't have seen anywhere else,
Right. What about divided by 13? Any divided by 13s?
No, you know what? I've played through a couple, but I never played through one that made me think I really needed to have it. You know, not that they're bad amps by any means, sure. But I just never played through one that's like, oh man, I really got to have that.
And how about Friedman?
I owned one at one point because I wanted to, the buzz. I wanted to see what it was all about, and I bought that 20 watt taco job that the smaller, sure. Didn't like it. Played through a few, found one that I did like, but I've never pulled the trigger on one. And the one I did like was the Jerry Cantrell signature which is a modified Brown Eye, I guess, or whatever, and then that's just a modified Marshall. But the Cantrell one sounded really good. I had way more gain than anyone would need. I had the gain way down. Probably the preamp gain was more like the 9 o'clock range, and it would rip your head off.
Right. You know?
Yeah. I thought that was a really good sounding amp. I'm going to zone out here. I need to probably list them or something like that. Oh, you know, I do have one Fender amp, actually. I've got a Fender Tone Master, which is an old custom shop amp that they made back in the early 90s. I have one of those, and
episode, we're definitely going to spend some time talking about the new Tone Master stuff, that whole series, and just about amps in general. Mike, it's great having you here.
Good to be here. I appreciate you letting me be a part of this.
Absolutely. All right, everybody. Till next time, this is Mike O. Get used to it. Very good.
Later.
You're listening to Guitar Talk with Dave and John.